Today we'll start with the sums of calorimetry. In this chapter, we will first write down the formulae. One question of 4 marks or two sums of 3 marks each, that means 6 marks, is always asked in calorimetry. See, initially you will have to understand the sums. Once you have understood the sums, and what I have given in our book, Anish Tutorial book, is more than enough. Nothing beyond that will come in the board exam. So if you have understood the sums and you are able to do it, then once that is through, this is scoring. Yes, you have to practice, and of course we will do the some of, besides the classwork sums which are done here, we will do some of the homework sums in the Zoom session also before the tests. So calorimetry sums formulae: heat absorbed or heat released. Of course, if someone is eating a substance, heat will be gained by that substance. But if you are leaving a hot substance in the open, then heat will be lost by that substance. Heat absorbed or heat released, the symbol used is Q. And Q is equal to MC delta T. But now if somewhere in a question paper you find capital H, you should understand with respect to the question what is H. H is heat released or heat absorbed instead of Q. M, mass of the substance, C, specific heat capacity of that substance, and delta T, in case heat is absorbed, it is rise in temperature, and if heat is released, it is fall in temperature. Now thermal capacity or heat capacity, both mean the same thing. So the word thermal is sometimes used instead of heat. C dash is Q upon delta T. So that is the basic formula. Heat capacity is amount of heat absorbed per unit degree Celsius or degree Kelvin rise in temperature. Why Kelvin rise in temperature? Instead of this, Q is MC delta T. So delta T will cancel. So C dash is also M into C. So you can use, depending on what is given in the question, Q upon delta T or C dash is MC. Then if there is only a change in state or phase, then there will be no change in temperature. See, either of the two happens. We have learned that in the theory. Either there is a change in phase or state, or there is rise in temperature. Both the things don't happen together. So if there is no change in temperature and there is just a change in phase, then the heat absorbed or released is called latent heat. Latent means hidden. It is called hidden because there is no rise in temperature. Heat is going, but you can't see any rise in temperature. That is, that heat absorbed or released is M into L. When you say heat absorbed, let's say a solid ice is converting to water. Then heat is absorbed by ice. If the reverse is happening, that is, if water is freezing to ice, then in that case, heat will be released by water. Only after it releases heat, it will convert to ice, solid. So that formula is mass of the substance, that is mass of water or ice, into latent heat. The value of latent heat of ice, you should know, 336 joule per gram. Where L is latent heat of fusion or freezing. Now principle of calorimetry or method of mixtures, it's one and the same thing. It's two different terms used, either you can call by principle of calorimetry or by method of mixtures. Heat lost by hot body is heat gained by cold body. So hot body will lose heat and cold body will gain heat till they attain the same final temperature, or in other words, till they attain thermal equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium means all are at the same temperature. So if all three bodies or all two bodies are at the same temperature, then in that case, you can use this M1, C1, delta theta fall, that is heat lost by hot body, is equal to M2, C2, delta theta rise. That's the cold body, heat gained by cold body. So here, delta theta fall is T1 minus T, and delta theta rise for the cold body temperature rise is T minus T2, where T is the final temperature of the mixture, T1 is initial temperature of hot body and T2 is initial temperature of cold body. So now here T1 is greater than T and T is greater than T2. So T1 greater than T, so that's why T1 minus T. And T is greater than T2, that is why T minus T2. Now sometimes it is not just hot body, cold body. There will be calorimeter also used, or thermal vessel that is used. Thermal vessel means calorimeter itself. So in that case, we will have to add calorimeter, that formula now I will write. See, now you have to be careful when calorimeter is given, that in the method of mixtures or method of calorimetry, if a calorimeter is used to prevent heat loss to the surroundings, then obviously if the details of the calorimeter are given, you have to take the calorimeter into account when you solve the sum. So now in the sums of calorimetry, if calorimeter's value is given, first thing you have to look is, from the question you have to find out whether the calorimeter had the hot body or did the calorimeter have the cold body inside it initially. If the calorimeter had the cold body inside it, 95% of the sums in the book you are given calorimeter is first containing cold body, and then after that hot body is dropped. So if the calorimeter is containing the cold body inside it, then whatever is the temperature of the cold body initially, that itself will be taken as the temperature of the calorimeter. Let's say you have hot water at 80 degrees Celsius being poured into cold water at 20 degrees Celsius, which was already there in a calorimeter. So then in that case, initial temperature of cold body is 20 degrees Celsius, and since the calorimeter was carrying this cold body initially, we will take the temperature of calorimeter also to be 20 degrees Celsius itself. So in this case, both of these, calorimeter and cold body, will gain heat, whereas the hot body, that is the hot water at 80 degrees Celsius, will lose heat. So in this case, this both have the same temperature, T2 degrees Celsius. So when you use heat loss by hot body, it is M1C1, T1 minus T. T1 is initial temperature of hot body, and T is final temperature of all, because that is, till that time the heat exchange happens, till all reach the same final temperature. And heat gained will be by both cold body and calorimeter, and M2C2, T2 minus T, this is for the cold body, and M3C3, T2 minus T, the same change in temperature will be for the calorimeter. So M3 and C3 will be the mass of the calorimeter, and C3 is specific heat capacity of the material of the calorimeter, which is generally copper. So those values will be given in the question. Now here we took T1 minus T because T1 is initial temperature of hot body, T is final temperature of all the mixture, and T2 is initial temperature of cold body and calorimeter. So these values will be positive. T1 minus T, T2 is greater than T, so again this is positive. T2 greater than T, so that is also positive. Now there is a possibility in one of the sums, there is a possibility that initially the calorimeter had hot substance and then cold substance was poured inside. So in that case, you have to read the question carefully and see what was there inside the calorimeter initially. If the calorimeter had the hot substance at T1 degrees Celsius initially inserted, then in that case, you will have to take both the hot body and calorimeter's initial temperature as T1. This is when the calorimeter has the hot body inside it initially, and later you are pouring the cold substance into it. So you have to first see what is given in the question. Did the calorimeter have the hot substance? In that case, both calorimeter and the hot body will lose heat, and the cold body will gain heat. So heat lost by hot body plus heat lost by calorimeter. See, this is different. There, calorimeter was gaining heat because initially it had the cold body. Now, calorimeter initially has hot body at T1 degree Celsius. So, calorimeter is also initially hot at T1 degree Celsius. So, both the hot body and calorimeter will lose heat. So, M1, C1, T1 minus T plus M3, C3. This is mass of calorimeter, specific heat capacity of the material of calorimeter. And again, same T1 minus T is equal to heat gained by cold body is M2, C2, T minus T2. That is the same, but here cold body is alone because that is being poured into calorimeter which had hot body. So now some values, these are all the formulae. Some values, mostly they are given in the question, but if they are not given and if it is required, then you will have to use these values. For example, specific heat capacity of ice, it is not same as water. Specific heat capacity of ice is 2.1 joule per gram degree Celsius. And this we saw in the heating curve of water also, that in the solid state, that when it was ice, there was a sharp rise in temperature, whereas when it became water, the slope was less steep. The rise in temperature was slow. So for water, specific heat capacity is 4.2 joule per gram degree Celsius, double that of ice. Same substance, only changed state, but still specific heat capacity of solid was different, specific heat capacity of liquid is different. For ice it was 2.1 joule per gram degree Celsius, for water it is 4.2 joule per gram degree Celsius. If that is converted to kg, it becomes 4200, because 1 gram is 1 upon 1000, so that 1000 will go on the numerator. So it will become 4200 joule per kg degree Celsius. Now in your sums, you have to be careful. If CTS unit is given for mass, then you will have to take this. If SI unit is given for mass, means mass is given as 2 kg, 4 kg, then you will have to take this. You can't have mass in gram and you take specific heat capacity in joule per kg. Full sum will go wrong. So be careful that all the units are in the same system of measurements. And final answer in your boards is expected in SI. So even if you have done in CTS, you first do everything and the last answer, whatever is asked, you will write in SI. That's the rule, though usually they are not very strict on those things. The latent heat of fusion of ice is 336 joule per gram. That means 1 gram of ice requires 336 joule to get converted to water at the same constant temperature, 0 degrees Celsius. Instead of 336 joule per gram, again 1 gram is 1 upon 1000 kg. So you can say 33,600 joule per kg. So instead of 336 joule per gram, you can write 33,600 joule per kg. So these are standard values, and note, many times, sometimes Kelvin and degree Celsius is interchanged one for the other. That is because one Kelvin change in temperature is same as one degree Celsius change in temperature. So this is important to remember, because Kelvin and degree Celsius, you are not using the absolute temperature, absolute, they are not asking you the value. They are only giving when you write this joule per kg degree Celsius. Even if it is joule per kg Kelvin, there is no harm. Kelvin and degree Celsius can be interchanged one for the other when change in temperature is being talked about. Yeah, absolute values are different. You have temperature in Kelvin is equal to temperature in degree Celsius plus 273. So if you have 0 degree Celsius, then the corresponding temperature in Kelvin is 273 Kelvin. So these are 33,000, this is one more zero will come here, this is into 1000, so it is 336,000
that many joule per kg, because I told you this gram is 1 upon 1000 of a kg. So here it will be 336 followed by 3 zeros, that many joule per kg. And 1 Kelvin and 1 degree Celsius, if it is just a change, rise or fall, then you can interchange, and Kelvin can be used instead of degree Celsius, because you are not talking about absolute value. Temperature in Kelvin and temperature in degree Celsius plus 273. So copy this, we will start with the sums in our Anish tutorial book, the classwork sums. First question on page 147. An iron ball requires 5000 joule of heat to raise its temperature by 10 degree Celsius. Calculate the heat capacity, that means C dash, for the iron ball. You have direct formula. Heat capacity is Q upon delta T. Delta T is 10 degree Celsius and heat required is 5000 joule. So if you write the unit also along with the magnitude, then it is easy to write the final answer's unit. You don't have to think over it, you will directly get the unit when you substitute. So it is C dash is 500 joule per degree Celsius. So that is the thermal capacity or heat capacity of the iron ball. Now second question, some heat is given to 120 gram of water and its temperature rises by 10 Kelvin. When the same amount of heat is given to 60 gram of oil, so a very important data is given, the same amount of heat which was supplied to water is given to 60 gram of oil. Then its temperature rises by 40 Kelvin. 40 Kelvin, so temperature of oil is rising faster. Obviously, oil has lower specific heat capacity as compared to water, so its temperature will rise fast. The specific heat capacity of water is given 4200 joule per kg Kelvin. So now since this is in kg and the mass was in gram, so I would suggest convert mass to kg by dividing it by 1000. So mass of water 120 gram, so divided by 1000 it becomes 0.12 kg. Rise in temperature of water is 10 Kelvin. Let's even the specific heat capacity of water is also given there, 4200 joule per kg Kelvin. Now this is Kelvin, Kelvin, so even if it was degree Celsius, chalega, because you are not talking absolute temperature, you are talking about rise in temperature. Oil mass 60 gram divided by 1000, so 0.06 kg. Rise in temperature of oil is 40 Kelvin. Let C2 be specific heat capacity of oil. In this case, same heat is supplied to both water and oil. So first we will consider water. What is the heat absorbed by water when heat is supplied to it? It is M1 C1 delta theta rise, the normal formula. M1 is 0.12 kg. C1 is 4200 joule per kg Kelvin. And delta theta rise is 10 Kelvin for water. So two zeros and two decimal places shifted. So it became 12 into 42 into 10. So that gives you 5040 joule. Now same heat is supplied to oil. So 5040 is M2 C2 delta theta rise for oil. And this rise was 40. And this mass was also different. It was 0.06 kg. Since specific heat capacity is in kg, so you had to take mass also in kg. You can't have this in gram and that in kg. Both should be in the same unit. You could have left mass in gram and converted this to 4.2 joule per gram Kelvin. But generally, in our board exams, there is rule that you write all the units in SI, not in CGS. So it is better to leave it this way. Anyway, final answer, either ways, you would have got 5040 joule itself. So here, when you carry out the division, so in that case you will get the answer as 2100 or 2100 joule per kg Kelvin. Here again, I am substituting the value with the unit kg Kelvin. So you know joule per kg Kelvin is the unit or specific heat capacity of oil. So if you substitute the unit with the value, the final answer you will automatically get along with the units. So always do that. We'll go on to the third sum.
So now in the third sum, you are given the heat capacity of a solid is one of mass 175 gram is 315 joule per degree Celsius. So mass is given and heat capacity, that is C dash, is given. And calculate the specific heat capacity. So please understand, specific heat capacity is C, heat capacity or thermal capacity is C dash. So now in this case you will use the formula C dash is MC, direct formula. Substitute the values, you will get C as 1.8, you will get it as 9.5, which is 1.8 joule per gram degree Celsius. Simple sum. As I told you, you substitute it along with the units, so automatically the answer you will get, not just the value but the units will also automatically come. Now the fourth question, it is given 0.120 kg of copper of specific heat capacity 100 calorie per kg degree Celsius at 20 degree Celsius is heated by a burner for 2 minutes, comma, the burner is supplying heat at the rate of 20 calorie per second. So how much total heat has been provided by the burner? It is providing 20 calorie per second for 120 seconds. So the total heat provided by the burner is heat per second into the time in seconds. So 20 calorie per second into 120 seconds. So it is 2400 calorie. So first we are finding how much heat is supplied by the burner, because that will be the heat gained by that solid copper, by the copper. So heat supplied by burner is 20 calorie per second into 120 seconds, that is 2400 calorie. The same heat supplied is used to increase the temperature of copper. So M is mass of copper, C is specific heat capacity of copper, and delta theta rise is the rise in temperature of copper. So this we know, we just calculated it as 2400 calorie. Mass of copper is 0.12 kg. This was given in the sum. 100 calorie per kg degree Celsius is also given. That is the specific heat capacity of copper. And rise in temperature, we are taking final temperature to be T. So the rise, its temperature rose from 20 degrees Celsius to T degrees Celsius. So the rise in temperature is T minus 20. So therefore I am taking these two numerical values down along with the unit. So now in this case unit is not required, because you know that the final temperature is asked, so it has to be in degrees Celsius. Because the initial temperature was given as 20 degrees Celsius, final temperature's unit will also be degree Celsius itself. So when you do this calculation, 200 is T minus 20. So you can shift 20 here, it becomes 200 plus 20, that is 220. That will be the final temperature of copper. So the final temperature of copper is 220 degree Celsius. This is what was asked, the final temperature. So mark the sum. This sum you can mark it as important. It is slightly different, but sometimes even some simple sums like this are asked in section 1. Usually you have around 70 to 75% of your paper is theory. The board questions, that which we are doing in Zoom, all the past board questions, 70 to 75% of the physics paper is theory. 25 to 30% is sums, and in sums generally calorimeter is the chapter in which there are more sums. It is not difficult once you practice, and if you have done it 2-3 times, it is very simple in scoring. Go on to the fourth sum now. Now in the fifth question, the question says that how much heat energy is gained when 0.6 kg of water at 25 degrees Celsius is brought to its boiling point. Specific heat capacity of water is given 4200 joule per kg degree Celsius. So mass is given 0.6 kg. Specific heat capacity of water is given 4200 joule per kg degree Celsius. And initial temperature was 25 and final temperature when it's brought to boiling point of water will be 100 degree Celsius. So heat gain, the simple formula, the first thing you learn, factors affecting how much heat is absorbed or released, MC delta T. So just substitute the values that you will get. You can shift the 0.61 decimal and remove one zero. So this became 6 into 420 into 75. 6 into 475 is 450 into 420. That is 189 followed by 3 zeros. And the heat supplied will be in joule. Because you look at the unit, heat will be in joule because this specific heat capacity was in joule per kg degree Celsius. If this value was in calorie, then the heat supplied would have been in calorie. So this is a very simple sum. Now the sixth sum, a solid of mass 25 grams and specific heat capacity 0.8 joule per gram degree Celsius at 120 degree Celsius is placed in 100 gram of water at 20 degree Celsius. So there are two things. There is a solid which is hot, it is initially at 120 degree Celsius, and there is water which is cold, which is 20 degree Celsius. Now mass of solid is 25 and mass of water is 100. So the mass is not the same, neither is the specific heat capacity the same. So please do not have any ideas in your head that 120 and 20, so uska average 70, aisa nahi hai. So you have to use heat equation and write that by Prince, let T be the final temperature of the mixture. Means till when will heat exchange happen? Till everything attains the same final temperature. Till that point. So by principle of calorimetry, heat loss by hot solid would be heat gained by cold water. So M1 C1 delta theta fall in temperature is N2 C2 delta theta rise in temperature. So now how will you take the fall in temperature? So M1 25 gram, C1 0.6 and fall in temperature will be 120 minus T. See, the final temperature will be somewhere between 120 and 20. It won't be the midpoint or the middle value. That's what I told you. Don't take any average and write. You have to do the calculations and find. So this is 120 minus T. That is the drop in temperature. And for water, mass is 100 gram. Specific heat capacity is 4.2 joule per gram degree Celsius. And rise in temperature in this case, final temperature will be more than 20. So it will be T minus 20. T was the final temperature, so here it will be T minus 20. So now here 25 into 0.8 is 20. 120 minus T. This multiplication will give you 420 T minus 20. So now you open the bracket. 20 into 120, 2400 minus 20T is 420T minus 8400. So you get the constant terms on one side, that is the T terms on one side, it becomes 440T, and the numeric values on the other side, it will become 10,800. So T is equal to 10,800 upon 440. So that value, when you do the calculations, it is 24.54 degree Celsius. That is the final temperature of the mixture. Sometimes question is asked, what is the assumption made? Now if this is asked, then you will have to write the assumption made in this principle of calorimetry is no heat is lost or gained from the surroundings. That is, the system is thermally insulated, which we are assuming. Practically that is not possible, and in this case you are only having hot water, hot solid and cold water, you are not considering even the calorimeter. So we will have sums in which even calorimeter is taken into account. So please copy all this in your notebook. We go on to the next sum, that is 7th. Now both the 7th and 8th sums are very identical, and in homework also there is a sum in which you are asked to find the thermal capacity, that is sum number 8 of homework. So those sums are very identical to each other. So in homework question number 8, you can refer this. For homework question 8, refer classwork 7 or classwork 8. They are both quite identical sums. Now in the first case, in sum number 7, you have three things. You are given hot water, cold water at 20 degrees Celsius, and there is a vessel in which first the cold water was there. So like we wrote in the formula today, you will have to take the temperature of cold water and vessel. Because cold water was there in the vessel first, initial temperature of vessel is same as temperature of cold water, that is 20 degrees Celsius. So here, the hot body is water at 60 degrees Celsius, and these both are the cold bodies at 20 degrees Celsius. Now you are asked, what is the thermal capacity or heat capacity of vessel? So in this case, you don't know M3, you don't know C3. And you need not find M3 and C3 individually. You need to find the product of M3, C3. That is C dash. Thermal capacity of vessel will be M3, C3. That will be the thermal capacity of vessel. It is written here. So obviously when three things are there, and you cannot directly in one line write M3, C3's value because that is not given, you will have to use the principle of calorimetry. The final temperature of all of the three is given as 30 degrees Celsius. So by principle of calorimetry, heat loss by hot water is heat gained by cold water plus heat gained by the vessel. Heat loss by hot water is heat gained by cold water plus heat gained by vessel, because these both were at the same 20 degrees Celsius, so both of them will gain heat. So here the formula is M1 C1 delta theta fall in temperature. This will be M2 C2 delta theta rise in temperature. And for the vessel it will be M3 C3 delta theta rise in temperature. So this and this will be same, because they have the same initial temperature and same final temperature. Now we need not find M3, C3 individually. This we call it as C dash, where M3, C3 is C dash or thermal capacity of vessel. So you are asked to find this C dash. So when we substitute the value, M1 is 80, M2 is, C1 is 4.2. See, water specific heat capacity is not given in this, but then you have to take it in the corresponding units, 4.2 joule per gram degree Celsius. Taken, fall in temperature is 60 to 30, 60 minus 30. Cold water, M2 is 100 gram, C2 is 4.2. Rise in temperature is 30 minus 20. And instead of M3, C3, we are writing C dash, and rise in temperature is same, 30 minus 20. So when you multiply this, you get 10,080 is equal to 4,200 plus 10 times C dash. When you shift the values, you get C dash is 5880 upon 10. So C dash is 588 joule per degree Celsius. That is the thermal capacity of the vessel. So now, same way you have the next sum, that is the 8th sum. In the 8th sum again you are given hot water, cold water and copper calorimeter. In this case it is given that initially cold water at 16 degrees Celsius is there in the calorimeter. So initial temperature of cold water and calorimeter will be the same. So T2 is equal to T3, that is 16 degrees Celsius. Again, water specific heat capacity we have to take. What you are asked again is M3, C3's multiplication or C dash. That is the thermal capacity of the copper calorimeter. So final temperature in this case is given 24 degrees Celsius. So heat lost by hot water
is heat gained by cold water plus heat gained by copper calorimeter. So M1 C1 delta theta fall is equal to M2 C2, that is the cold water's parameters, into delta theta rise, plus third one is M3 C3 delta theta rise. So M1 is 40, C1 is 4.2, and the rise, the fall in temperature is 36 minus 24, that will be 12. And cold water M2 is 50, C2 is 4.2, and rise in temperature is 24 minus 16, plus M3 C3 is C dash, and rise in temperature is 24 minus 16. So this multiplication gives you 168 into 12 is 210 into 8 plus 8 times C dash. So 2016 is 1680 plus 8 times C dash. So you shift 1680 on this side, you will get 336 upon 8. That will give you C dash as 42 joule per degree Celsius. You note that joule per degree Celsius, here when we define thermal capacity, we say the amount of heat energy required to raise the temperature of the entire substance. So mass is not being specified, so there is no kg or gram in the unit. Whereas when we say specific heat capacity, at that time we say for raising the temperature of 1 gram of substance or 1 kg of substance. So gram will be there in the unit of specific heat capacity, but in the unit of heat capacity or thermal capacity, mass, that is gram or kg, will not be specified. So with this, we will stop today's class, and you can do homework from question number 1 to 8. Sums 1 to 8, you can do it for homework. In the next 2-3 days, you can copy this, try this, and do it, so that maybe by Friday you can do the first 8 sums, which will be based on this. And I already told you homework question number 8. For sum number 8, try for question number 7 or 8, which you have just done. It's just changed in numbers. So that's it. So bye, students.